I thank you, Lord, that we can do this, oh Lord. I thank you so much that we can get these Sunday school lessons out. I thank you that we live in a time, Lord, where we're not limited by being restricted at home, or we can use things like the internet, we can use technology, Lord, and we can still get the gospel out. Lord, I pray today that you will help me to teach your lesson. You will help me, Lord, to get the message across as we come upon Easter, Lord, as we think upon the cross, as we think upon your love, as we think upon what it is that you did for us. We pray today, Lord, that you will help us all, Lord, to have trust and faith in you as the media scares us with this COVID-19 stuff. Lord, as people's lives are turned upside down, help us, Lord, to have trust and faith in you and you alone, that this is all in your hand and your guidance and your control, Lord. I pray that you will speak through me, Lord. I pray that you will help the audience at home, as it is much harder to be attentive to a video than it is in person, Lord. I pray that they will all be attentive to this, Lord. I pray that every kid will listen to the message, Lord, and will try to follow along, Lord. And I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So, you guys know that this is not my style. Okay, I like to have you guys here in person. I like to be able to interact with you guys. So, you're going to have to try extra hard to pay attention. You have to try extra hard to follow along, because I'm not going to be able to call on you and ask you questions like I prefer to do. So, I'm going to read the verses. I'm not going to be able to have you do it, of course, but I need you guys to have your Bibles open at home. I expect you to have your Bibles open at home. I expect you to be following along as I give you the verses. Next week is Easter. You're going to do Easter egg hunts. Many kids are going to overload on sugar. Many kids are going to watch shows about Easter bunnies, Easter eggs, all the Easter stuff. Some of you might even watch some shows on the cross. And that's what we kind of want to talk about today, is the cross. I want you guys to think about, when you see a cross, what do you think about? We have crosses today. People have them as decorations. People have them as jewelry. They're hanging from their walls. They're hanging from their necks. They're hanging from earrings. We see crosses on bumper stickers. We see crosses everywhere. What does the cross mean to you? What do you think of when you see the cross? What we should think of, you guys, is we should be thinking of forgiveness. Okay? For us as Christians, the cross means God's forgiveness, God's love, God taking our sins away on that cross, God's show of love toward us on that cross. That's what the cross means to us. Let's go back to the time of Christ. That is not what the cross meant to them. You didn't find people wearing crosses on jewelry. You didn't find people hanging crosses on their walls at home at the time of Christ. What did the cross mean at the time of Christ? What was it? What did it mean to them? The cross was, it was a Roman execution device. Okay? The cross was simply two pieces of wood that were just nailed together into the shape of a cross. And they would take your hands and they would take and put a nail through your wrists, stretch out your wrists, put a nail through each wrist. They would put you, they would take your feet, stack one on top of the other, put a nail through both feet, have it angled down. As they put that cross up in the air, your body weight would pop your shoulders out of socket. So the whole time you're hanging on that cross, you're fighting with pain from your hands, from your shoulders, the whole time that you're up there. And the whole time that you're up there, you're trying to breathe. Because what happens is, from your body weight leaning forward, you're crushing your lungs. And you can breathe in, but you can't breathe out. You can't exhale. So you have to stand up on your feet. And when you stand up on your feet, that nail on your foot is going to press. It's going to cut into your feet the whole time you stand up. But you have to do it in order to breathe. So the whole time you're on that cross, you're fighting with pain from your hands to your shoulders to your feet, trying to breathe. And the whole time you're up there, you're just managing pain and managing breathing the whole time you're there. And the Romans mastered doing this as a torture device. They'd make you live for as long as they could and let you suffer. You could suffer for days like that, just trying to breathe, trying to manage the pain, and there was no escape. You weren't coming off. You were going to die. So you just hung there and suffered. And for Jesus, it was worse, because before he went on that cross, they had scourged him. So most of the skin on his back was gone. His whole back was ripped up. So every time he stood up and down, the wood splinters on that cross is rubbing the raw on his back. Constant pain, nonstop. Okay? Turn to Mark 15, you guys. Today, we're going to cover the events that happened, some of the events that happened on the cross. We're going to cover some of the events that happened after he died. All right? Mark 15, verses 24 and 25. And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them, what every man should take. And it was the third hour, and they crucified him. All right? So turn to Luke 23, will be our next verse. All right? So this said that they put Jesus on the cross at the third hour. Sixth graders, I know that most of you know the answer to this, all right? What time is that? The way that the Bible works is that it starts the hours at sunrise. So 6 a.m. So the third hour is the time after 6 a.m. 6 plus 3 is 9. They put Jesus on the cross at 9 a.m., all right? Think about his mourning. They had arrested him the night before. They tried him with Ananias. They tried him with Caiaphas. They put him in a holding place temporarily for a few hours. They brought him back that morning for a third hearing. They convicted him. They drug him to Pilate. Pilate hears he's from Galilee. They drag him back to Herod. Herod kicks him back to Pilate. Pilate sends him to be scourged. They take him, they scourge him. They bring him back to Pilate. They walk him down the Via Dolorosa to be hanged. All that happened before 9 a.m. The Jews had wanted Christ dead for a long time. And now they finally had him. They were not going to waste any time. They were not going to let him get away. They were not going to give the disciples a chance to release him. They were not going to give Pilate a chance to release him. Pilate knew he was innocent, didn't want to convict him. So they were going to get him on the cross. And by 9 a.m., they had him nailed and up on that cross. I want you to think about this too. I want you to think about this from Christ's perspective. He's hanging on that cross. He came to this world because he loves you and me. He came to this world because he loves those people that were on the ground, those people that put him on the cross. They hated him. They hated him. He was on that cross, suffering with pain, trying to breathe, dying. They were on the ground making fun of him. And he still loved them. If that was you, these people had beaten you. They had made fun of you. They smacked you in the face. They punched you. They spit on you. They drug you all over town because they wanted you dead. And now you're on the cross suffering, trying to breathe. How would you feel about it? Would you love them? I think most of us honestly would probably hate them. Most of us would hate them. Let's read how Jesus responds. Luke 23, verse 34. Then said Jesus, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they parted his raiments and cast lots. The next verse will be in Matthew 27. Turn to Matthew 27. They are on the ground making fun of Jesus, who is suffering in pain, who's trying to just breathe. They're making fun of him. The thieves on the cross, two thieves, one on each side. Initially, they both made fun of Jesus, both of them. And he's hanging on that cross, forgiving them. He's hanging on that cross, praying for the forgiveness of the people on the ground that are making fun of him. That's the difference between us and God, you guys. God forgives. God loves. God knows us, and He can forgive us, even when we can't forgive. That was why Jesus came. At some point on that cross, one of those thieves changed. We don't know when, we don't know why he changed, but he changed. And he transferred, he changed from making fun of Jesus to forgive me, to please remember me when you enter your kingdom. And instead of Jesus saying, you've been making fun of me the whole time, who do you think you are? He said, today you'll be with me in paradise. The difference between us and God is God can forgive. God loves us. Even at his darkest hour, Jesus was loving them and praying for their forgiveness. While he hung there on that cross, he's telling John to take care of Mary. He's caring for his own mother while he's trying to breathe and dealing with suffering and pain. That's the difference between us and God. Today in heaven, you guys, listen. That same Jesus is up there in heaven right now. Right now, wanting to forgive you, just like he forgave that thief on that cross. He wants to forgive you in heaven today. When you pray, that same Jesus is listening to your prayer request just as he listened to that thief and taking your prayer request to the Father today, right now. Today, that same Jesus wants to take away your sins. Just ask him. Tell him. Tell him that you believe like that thief on the cross did. Ask him to take your sins away. And he will. He will. Okay? Let's read what happens next. Matthew 27, verses 45 and 46. Now at the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus went to the cross at the third hour, 9 a.m. He hung there from 9 a.m. to the sixth hour, which is going to be noon. Okay, 6 a.m. plus the 6th hour is noon. He's going to hang there, trying to fight pain, trying to breathe. People on the ground making fun of him, dealing with John and his mother, dealing with the other thieves on the cross, or the other thief on the cross. I don't see where he ever talked to the one that didn't stop making fun of him. Till noon. Then at noon, all of a sudden, the sky just went. We don't know how black. I don't know if that means just this massive thundercloud rolled over and it just darkened over. It was like nighttime. You could see stars. I don't know. We don't know how dark was dark. We don't know whether it encompassed the whole world, Israel, Jerusalem. We don't know. But it was enough to get mentioned in the Bible. And I personally, my personal opinion, I can't back this one up, is that I would believe at that moment that probably everybody on the ground just probably went quiet. They're making fun of Jesus. They're laughing at Jesus. And all of a sudden, it goes dark. Whoa. And I think that it probably went silent. And people stopped. And they just watched. Because this was weird. This was strange. This wasn't something they expected, and they knew that there was something there, so they're just watching. And it stayed that way until the ninth hour. Okay? The ninth hour is 3 p.m. So from noon to 3 p.m., you have darkness. I believe you have silence. And then Jesus cries out all of a sudden, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And he says, I thirst. That's in one of the other books, of the other gospels. And one of the guys on the ground runs, grabs a sponge, puts some vinegar on it, holds it up for Jesus to drink. The other people on the ground say, leave him alone. We want to see what's going to happen. They knew that there was something going to happen. They expected it at this point. This was different than other crucifixions. For some reason, they were expecting Elijah. I have no idea why they expected Elijah. But let's see what will happen. But I want you to think about his statement. Why would God say that he had been abandoned, forsaken? Why would Jesus say that God had abandoned or forsaken him? Why would he say that? That's what we have to try to remember, why Jesus went to the cross in the first place. He went to the cross in the first place to pay for our sins. Okay? You need to understand that, I would say from the beginning of time, but even before time, for all of eternity, Jesus the Son and God the Father had never, ever been separated, ever. They had perfect unity, perfect peace, perfect togetherness, always together in perfect love. And at this moment, I believe this was the moment that Jesus took your sins, my sins, everybody's sins, every sin that we have ever committed, every sin we ever will commit on himself at that moment. God is not capable of looking at sin. That is why we need Jesus, because God cannot look on us as sinners. We are separated from God because of our sins. And at this moment, Jesus went from being perfection to a sinner by taking our sins on himself. Imagine this, you guys. Just imagine this. Someone that you trust with all your heart would always be there for you. Mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, friend, teacher, someone. Someone that you have absolute love and faith and you believe they'll always be there for you. And in your moment of need, they turn their back on you. And they're angry at you. And you're alone. At that moment, I believe God the Father separated from Jesus. Something he had never, ever, 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 for all of eternity, ever felt. Jesus knew that it was going to happen. He knew it was going to happen, but I think it was still a lot for him to handle. It was still more than he was ready to handle with separation from the Father because of our sins. And then Jesus says, "It is finished. It is done." And he dies. So Matthew 27, we're going to read 50 through 54 and read what happens when he dies. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from top to bottom. And the earth did quake and the rocks rent. And the graves were opened and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after the resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God." It's 3 p.m. in the afternoon. It's been dark. Jesus is crying out now. He says it is finished. And he dies. He dies. They take a spear and they'll jam it inside under his ribs. And it's going to go through the lungs, through the heart. Water's going to come out, because when they're on the cross, event over time, their lungs, their heart fills with water, and that water came squirting out. He was dead. They punctured him with a spear. He was dead. And when he died, the ground shook. And it didn't just shake. It was enough to crack rocks. It wasn't a tremor. This was an earthquake. Probably terrified people. They had been watching the darkness all along, paying attention, and now the ground is shaking. At the exact moment that Christ died, they had to be scared. And in the temple, and I want you guys to think of the meaning of this. I know some of you guys know and some of you don't. Think of this. It said the curtain, huge curtain, that separated the temple from the Holy of Holies. the place where the priest went in every year to meet with God for the forgiveness of Israel's sins, to sprinkle blood, a place that was holy, a place that they couldn't enter. The priest was the only one that entered that, and only entered it once a year. And that curtain that separated that room from the rest of the temple was ripped in half from top to bottom. Why do you think that matters? Why would it point out that it was ripped from top to bottom? Because I think that signifies. That signifies that it was God that did it. God opened up the door for us to come into Him. We don't need to go through some extra sacrifice. We don't need to go through a priest. We don't need anything special. No special confession to a priest or a person or a church or anything else. God opened up that door for us when Jesus died, for us to go to God by ourselves on our own. That's what that temple, that's what that curtain being ripped in half signifies, was God opening up the door, giving us access to the Holy of Holies on our own. You can pray to God right now, yourself. You don't need the church. You don't need anyone else. You can pray to God yourself. That sacrifice that Jesus made, it also signified no more need for sacrifices. He was the last and final sacrifice that God will ever accept. No more sacrifices. No more sprinkling of blood in the Holy of Holies. The blood of Christ was it. It's done. There's nothing else we need to do. Jesus was the final sacrifice for our forgiveness. Now, verses 52 and 53 kind of get weird. You don't hear much preaching on these verses, all right? It said that the graves were opened and that the bodies came up. I'm assuming the earthquake did that, all right? But it also said that at the resurrection, which we're going to cover next week, those bodies stood up and walked into Jerusalem. This isn't some weird sci-fi zombie movie where people act creepy and they're doing scary, horrible things. I don't see here where anybody was scared. Nothing weird. No Hollywood. They walked in. People knew that these were dead people walking in. We don't know what they looked like. I don't think they were skeletons, but I don't know. And we don't know what they did when they got there. Okay? Personal opinion. I can't back it up with scripture. Because we're not told. Personal opinion, they walked into Jerusalem. People saw them, said, whoa. And then they went up to heaven. Personal belief, my opinion, this was God showing these people what they could do because of what Jesus did. They saw the dead go to heaven. It's my opinion, okay? And the last thing that's in here is that on the ground is the centurions. These men, these were hardened Roman soldiers. They'd been through this the whole way through. They saw Jesus from beginning to end. When he died, it said the centurion, and it doesn't specify who else, but there were others, and I'm going to believe it's some of those Roman soldiers. They believed truly this was the Son of God. I want you to imagine how you would feel. These men thought Jesus was crazy. The Son of God. Who is the Son of God? You're up there bleeding everywhere. They thought he was crazy. They had taken Jesus. They had scourged him. They had whipped him with an inch of his life and ripped the skin from his body. They had beaten him. Then they took him back and they had sat him down, took a loop of thorns and crushed it onto his head with blood running down his face. And even after seeing him suffer like that, they spit on him, they smacked him in the head with a stick, and then they drug him out, took him down, nailed him to a cross and put him up there and made fun of him, gambled for his clothes while he was up there suffering. And after doing that, they realized, I had just done this to the Son of God. What am I going to do? I didn't know. I have to imagine that they were terrified. I would be. I'd be terrified if I did that to the Son of God himself. I'd be terrified. If I die, I'm going to go stand before God. And I got to face up to what I did. I don't want to do that. I don't want to face God in this situation. But if I live, I got to live with what I did. How do I do this? If it's me, I'm searching for forgiveness. I'm looking for some way to be forgiven. And personal opinion tells me that that had to have led them to the disciples. It had to. There's no other forgiveness. I believe we're going to see the centurion in heaven. I really do. Can't prove it. But these men believed and they were scared. Okay? I want to finish up today, you guys, with why this happened. With why did this happen? Understand, Jesus was God. He was God the Son. Everything that he suffered, everything that he went through, he didn't have to do it. He could have come off of that cross anytime he wanted to, but he didn't. Why? He did it because he knew there was no other way. God had determined that there had to be a sinless sacrifice to pay for the sins that we've committed, that we will commit. How many people have ever lived that were sinless outside of Christ? Nobody. There was no one else. God himself had to do it. God himself loved us so much, loved the world, for God so loved the world that he stayed on that cross for every one of us. That's why he did it. This all happened because God loves us very, very much. Today, I will finish up just saying what he did on that cross is a free gift to every human being. Believe and call on him. Just tell him. Tell him. Tell him you want that gift. Tell him you believe. Tell him he's your Savior. Go to Christ and give yourself to him. If you don't know how, talk to Mom and Dad. Give Pastor a call. He would love it if you would call him and ask about salvation. That would make his day. Call me. Call one of us. But take care of it today. All right? That's where we're going to stop. Next week, we're going to move on to the resurrection for Easter. And then we're going to step back into our lesson in Acts, and we'll continue with the journeys of Paul and Barnabas. Okay? Next week's Easter. Thank God. Tell God thank you for what he did. Father in heaven, I thank you today. I thank you today for everything that was done 2,000 years ago in Jerusalem. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for coming to pay for our sins. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving us. You know how bad we are. You know our sins. You know what we're going to do, and you know what we have done, and you still love us. You still want us with you. Thank you so much. I pray today, Lord, that there is anyone out there, anyone that has not come to you. I pray, Lord, that they'll think upon their self, think upon their sins, think upon their walk with you, and whether they have a real relationship with you, and they'll get that right. I pray today, Lord, that you'll help the other teachers to be ready with their lessons. I pray today, Lord, you'll help us as we go through this virus and these quarantines, that you'll help us all to trust in you, to understand that there is nothing that is out of your control. There's nothing that's out of your hands, that it's all, Lord, under your hand, and that you have full control of it, and that we have nothing to fear if we just trust in you. Help us to use wisdom, to follow our guidance, to follow our leadership, Lord, to submit to our government, but to put our trust and faith in you, not in anything else. I do pray this in Christ's name. Amen.